Hello, and welcome to another episode of Blatant Filler. I'm one of the hosts, JJ, and I'm joined by my fellow co-hosts, Marc.
Hello, hello.
And Collin.
Hi there.
And today we will be doing a bit of a different episode, as we will be looking at the shows of Simulcast Season Spring 2016. Specifically, a few of the shows. We're not going to cover the entirety of the season, just what we watched and what we really want to talk about, and our overall thoughts on the series as a whole, as well as looking at what we are excited for the next season, which is Summer 2016. As we will be covering multiple series in this episode, we'll actually call out if we're about to talk about spoilers for the series, which we probably will. So, much like the old episodes of Divergent Cast, there will be annotations in either the description of the blog post below or the description itself, so feel free to use them to move around if there's any shows you don't want to hear any spoilers for. So, first off, let's start it off by talking about one of the more major series of the season, Kabanari of the Iron Fortress, or, as it's most commonly known, Attack on Trains. So
zombies on trains.
Yeah, it's basically zombies on. So Kabanari is made by the same by Wit Studio, which was the same studio that did the anime to Attack on Titan. So there's some very clear correlations going on here. It's an original series, by the way.
Well, for starters, I think Kabanari of the Iron Fortress was much less bleak than Attack on Titan.
Yeah, and honestly, that's my first major kind of... If you're going head-to-head with the two, I think Attack on Titan's a much stronger show, and that's, like, the primary reason. This... The world of Kabanari does not feel near as persistent and dangerous as
Attack on Titan. As well as the
It just didn't feel as hopeless, and that undermined the situation the characters were in.
Yeah, and it doesn't help that a lot of the characters felt like they have had an extra coating of plot armor on them.
It was super shiny. They were always shiny. Whereas all the characters in Attack on Titan were always dirty, these were always shiny.
Except for the one character who died in the second to last episode, pretty much all the characters never felt like they were in any real danger.
And even the guy who died, the moment you saw him walk on screen, you knew he was going to die. There's no way Fatty McFatface was going to live through the whole thing.
The thing is, there I did like certain aspects of it compared to Attack on Titan. Like, I really love the main character compared to Eren.
Yes. Don't get me wrong. I think the show was pretty damn good. I think its strongest point is with its art direction, and especially towards the end of the series where it just kind of went into the full badass action type show. It really hit that kind of 80s anime vibe.
Yeah.
Unlike much has recently, and it became very enjoyable because of that to me. I wasn't going to watch it for the bleak story or any type of thematic push or, anything like that the way I would Attack on Titan. I went to just see, hey, this dude just grafted a fucking pile bunker on his arm.
Let's see that happen.
Right? It got to that point for me, and once it did get to that point, I totally enjoyed it.
Yeah, to me, this was the popcorn blockbuster anime of the season. You don't go in with high expectation. You go in expecting action,
And you know what? I think it strongly delivered
that. Yeah.
The animation quality. I can't say I'm a huge fan of the more 80s leaning art style, though I know why they did it. But the animation quality was utterly fantastic. You can tell they used a lot of film cut techniques and stuff in it. They put some serious budget into this show, and it did pay off a lot.
And I did like the setting a whole lot. Steampunk.
Samurai with guns is a really cool setting.
Yeah, steampunk samurai.
Powered guns. So in that sense, it was a little bit above the fray of the usual fare that you might see. There were some original ideas here and there that I think made it worth watching. Yeah.
Well, you don't actually see that many steampunk-related anime. Off the top of my head, the only one I can really think of is Attack on Titan and Last Exile. And that's kind of about it.
There. I'm sure there
I'm
were.
I'm sure there's a few.
yeah.
Oh God. One very
they
recently
have gone very generic
was kind of
present time or shortly 10 years into the future. They could have done all of those things.
Scrap Princess had a little bit of steampunk elements, but it was mainly a fantasy series.
Yeah. Comet Lucifer. Like it definitely had some steampunk elements and aesthetics, but it was. The technology level was far above steampunk, so.
Yeah. So in that sense, the setting felt relatively real.
Right.
And for that reason alone, fighting the Kabane zombie hordes made it much more, you know, believable or threatening in a way. If you really only go against them with muskets and swords and steam powered crossbows.
Yeah.
It ratchets up the tension quite a bit.
Yeah, it definitely does.
Did anybody else, when the princess like pulled out her bow and it like had a trigger on it or something, did anybody else just look at that and go, "That is the stupidest thing I've seen all season"?
Yeah.
I'm like. Great. I have an engineering degree and I have no fucking clue how that thing was supposed to work. Like,
well, I don't have an engineering degree and I thought that's fantastic.
Oh yeah, it was gloriously stupid, but it was very stupid.
That probably sums up the show very nicely. It was gloriously stupid.
Yeah. And none of the characters were really that well made, and
I thought they were enjoyable, but they did was fill their role.
Yeah, pretty much.
I'm not going to go back, and so you know who was an amazing character? That engineer chick who took her shirt off.
Like, I mean, that's still the best scene of the
pretty
season.
Amazing.
I mean, yeah, no,
character moment.
She definitely had her. She definitely had her charms, but you know, she ain't in the top five waifu rankings.
That's probably the only defining character moment that's worth going to the show back for. Strong female engineer. Who has ever seen that? Recently, so
yeah, but that ending though, it really didn't do much.
You know what? When I just sat back and accepted, we're going full on action stupidity. I was perfectly fine with it, and I really liked the little like nod at the end because you know throughout the whole end fight, I was just like, how is he still alive? What happened? And then when like, they just subtly slip into the end, oh, the fucking final boss actually cured him before he went and just... Like, I thought that was a nice little subtle way to wrap it up without just, oh, hey, you know, without, oh, I found this on his corpse. I thought that was a much more... Just a nice, much more intelligent way to handle it than it could have been done.
If they had actually killed him off, it would have been a more ballsy way to end it, but... I wasn't really.
Was anything about this show super ballsy though?
No.
Like.
That's.
Well,
I mean,
everything built up to blowing up the Death Star or the sinking of
Pretty
the Titanic.
Much.
11 episodes and it had to end that way, and there wasn't really anything else.
Right. I honestly.
Any other way it could have ended, compared to maybe Attack on Titan, where the last thing we see is the Titan
crazy cliffhanger that
wall.
Forced me to go read the whole next season's worth of manga.
So I mean, there was no, oh my god, the surprise revelation. What could that possibly mean? Well, everything was pretty much on a rail, if you will, to lead up to that ending, and it took us there, and it did that thing.
Yeah, it did the
thing. And in that sense, I was, perfectly happy with it. Also, it being only an 11-episode show. It didn't have any extraneous filler or, unnecessary detours or character development that didn't pay off. It just did its thing.
Overall, this was just
really well.
It was just a solid show that you could kick back and enjoy and not have to think about too hard. And as far as shows that are pretty blatant ripoffs of something successful, I say this clocks in pretty high because you look at all the other, ripoffs of stuff like Sword Art and stuff, and they're usually not very good. So,
well, to be fair, the source material isn't that good for Sword Art Online.
Yeah.
I suppose moving on after that bombshell, let's move on to My Hero Academy. So that was a superhero show.
This was my anime of the season. I gave it a solid 8. My feeling on this is just they went out and said, you know what, we really like shonen. We don't think we have to do anything super different or special to make a shonen enjoyable. We're just going to make the best damn shonen we can. And guess what? It was pretty freaking damn good shonen. And I am extremely excited for season two because I thought it did a really good job developing its characters and, you know, defining its central, you know, plot and conflicts in season one, and managed to deliver some very satisfying action and plot, even within it basically being an introduction for what will end up to be a long-running shonen. So, yeah, I was very, very impressed with this overall. I think this is the best Bone show I've seen in a good long while.
Yeah, it's definitely been
given their troubles in the last few seasons, and I'm extremely excited about where they're going to go from here.
Yeah, and I did like the wrinkle, which, without a doubt, came from the source material, that this is a world where the majority of people have some kind of weird superpower. And what does that mean to somebody who is, you know, essentially the outcast by being absolutely screechingly regular?
Pretty much, yeah.
And not wanting to be regular. So on that level, I really enjoyed how you got pulled into the show.
Mm-hmm. Well, the thing that immediately just gripped me and wouldn't let go was at the very first episode, the scene where, you know, he's freaking 4 years old and told he doesn't have the superpower, and his mom's just crying on him, and that, like, that's the defining, that, you know, he's just like, that's the worst thing you could have done. I wanted to hear was that, you know, all I wanted you to say was that I could still be a hero. Like, that was an extremely emotional scene for episode one, and really just immediately established the entire central premise, main character, and central conflict of the show in a single scene.
I'm agreeing with all of what you've said up until now. Like, that's exactly how I feel. This show is really enjoyable. It's as shonen as can be, and just really well done. But the characters were all pretty damn fun. Like, well, the in-universe equivalent of Superman. He's
All Might.
All Might.
It's amazing.
Yeah, he's so fun of a character.
I like how they really go, you know, it's basically Batman's mindset playing Superman.
Pretty much.
Because he's pretty much, I have to be the symbol for peace. You know, the world fucking disintegrates if I'm not here. And that's not being said out of, like, being overly confident or having too high of an opinion of him. We saw clearly through the actions of the villains that the world as they know it disintegrates if he is not there to fill that role, and that he knows he is filling that role, and what he... Yep. All Might was a really fantastic character in this first season with a lot of complexity and depth to what he does and the decisions he makes while still filling the role of the typical shonen mentor.
Yeah, and I really like how they change up his design to where it's really round, really muscular, and then when he gets to the small form, he's really small, and he's just
Crony.
Completely sharp. He's just completely sharp angles as well.
Yeah.
Like, ridiculously sharp.
The shadows to make him look so much like an American comic book character when he's, you know, when he goes into superhero mode and stuff. Yeah, the art direction on this show, and I immediately went and started reading the manga after it ended because, And the first chapter has a bit of his thought process when designing the, like, you know, four main characters. And on All Might, he put a lot of thought into that design about the transformations and everything. It's pretty interesting if you want to go give it a look.
Yeah, I think I remember reading that as well, like, if I remember hearing right, he mentioned that a lot of people were telling him, no, don't draw him like that or something like
A lot, and he was just like, no, that's, you know, they were like, he looks too much like an American comic book character, and he's like, that was what I'm going for.
Yeah, I also like the fact that All Might is the character that's living on borrowed time. Because it's if Superman had cancer or something.
Yeah, which just helps increase, you know, to his character depth.
It raises all the stakes about it. Mm-hmm. You first think he's this enormously solve-everything overpowered character, and then slowly but surely his handicap gets introduced.
And another thing I have to say
more
is that,
more of an issue as the show goes on.
Yeah, season one, it might not have deviated from your typical shonen formula that much. With what's going on with All Might and all of that stuff that's just been set up, you know, in future seasons, it's going to start, you know, stepping out of its comfort zone and really exploring some interesting concepts and, you know, ways to define its characters through actual tragedy.
Yeah,
there was a lot going on. I really liked the show in particular. It felt at first like, oh, this, you know, the Japanese version of Spider-Man or the Japanese version of X-Men Academy. But there were enough twists and wrinkles about it that made it just really compelling to keep watching.
Japanese X-Men Academy is like the perfect thing, peg of what it could have been, and I'm so glad it wasn't. I'm so glad it was more, like, more simple than that. Not more boring, just more simple.
Yeah. And the fact that when he inherits that power, it has such a huge drawback for him, at least initially. Yeah. That was also another wonderful wrinkle. Like, how do you deal with that? Now, like, you're given the power that you've been asking your whole life to have. Every time you use it, you half shatter your body.
Yeah, that's definitely a really nice wrinkle into the inheriting, basically being the inheritor of a hero's role of that sort.
And it immediately forces him to go into you can't just apply brute strength to your problem. You have to think it through and be really selective in your application of power. It's not like, you know, with great power comes great responsibility. It's like, with great power comes the ability to shatter your entire leg.
Now, my biggest issue with the show does come from that being the central, like, kind of crux of his personal problem with the power. It feels like it's one of those, given enough time, he's going to overcome it, and then, then you're good. And in that, it kind of undermines the central conflict for the main character for me. I kind of think I would prefer it if it was like, oh, if you hurt yourself too bad, you're going to be permanently injured. Like, you will shatter your body. If he had the ability to break his body so badly by, you know, having to use his power when he shouldn't, that he could permanently lose it, or, you know, kill himself by the, you know, Newtonian, you know, reaction, like, that I think would give the series just a bit more of a, you know, climactic oomph.
Where it's, well, they're, like, giving, you know, a little bit of a hint of that, and I don't know if they explore that at it's all, like, in the manga, where the nurse says, you know, yes, I can heal you back up, but it's so taxing on your body. If we did this all the time, you would die from the stress of recovery.
Even then, it's like, yeah, if it's been a couple of days since you last, you know, went Super Saiyan and punched a guy, and your friend's about to die, what? There's no question there. Fucking break your legs. You're going to be healed in 45 minutes. Like, and I think that's where I think the main area of the show could be a little bit stronger is if it increased the... if it gave us a little bit more reason to be, you know, to not think the hero or the main character, to give him a little bit more of a risk involved.
Yeah, I'd like him to be a little bit more cautious about, you know, I'm just going to break my arm now.
Or at least have a reason to seriously contemplate that risk.
Right.
Because, you know,
maybe today is not the day where I feel like breaking my arm.
Right. I'm going to hop over and compare it to ReZero for a second. In ReZero, a huge crux of that show has become that the main character has no idea if he's going to respawn if he dies again. It's happened in the past. He does not know how it works. You know, it might be, what if you have limited lives, basically? And that causes him to make, you know, have a, if that show, if that wasn't part of it, if it was just like, yeah, I can just fucking stab myself in the throat and regen with no question.
And initially it seemed like there wasn't much of an impact on him.
Right, his internal conflict.
It was wearing on his mental strain of, you know, dying multiple times.
Right,
and really
I think
starting to
that
wear on
sort
him.
Of internal conflict for the main character is something that Boku no Hero Academia is missing and could greatly benefit from.
Yeah, I think they intentionally made the choice to keep this very light and very accessible and very, you know, PG.
Right.
Well,
it could push it much farther.
Yeah, and I fully assume it will push it forward.
Yeah, I mean,
and, you know, I have not read very far into manga, so I don't know what actually happens or anything, but I would, if I had just wager a guess, we're probably going to end up with a situation like every time he uses his power, it pulls some of All Might's life force or something like that.
Yeah.
Like, well, he is actively weakening and killing All Might to inherit the power, and that causes a much greater internal conflict with him about how sparingly he can use it.
Yeah. Well, I will say that at near the end, it did start to get a little bit darker, I felt.
Yes, and I have heard from people who do read the manga that it starts looking at more of the side characters and developing them far more, which I don't think it did a bad job of so far, but it is a direction I like hearing that it takes, and that it does get darker. It starts to stray from the straight shonen path, and it starts, you know, it just comes into its own and really starts defining itself.
Well, a lot of the side characters were pretty enjoyable themselves. It's just
they have interesting personalities, but you know, we don't know what's going on with the frog girl, or you know, there are several of that's a large cast of characters that are all very interesting and obviously well thought out, but we really haven't been even you know, Ida told us what was going on, and that's about all we know of him, and we know more about him than anybody except for Izuku and Bakugo.
But anything else we want to mention about My Hero Academy?
No, I'm really looking forward to the next season, and I hope it doesn't get too dark. This I think right now, if it moves from PG to PG-13, I think that would be fine.
Yeah, I don't think really anybody's like coming in and stabbing Urochichi or whatever her name was in the face or something. It doesn't turn into ReZero.
It doesn't turn into Berserk.
that would be a jump.
Because I think there is, you know, room in anime for kid-friendly shows that, you know, are really fun and really accessible and show an interesting cast of character that break out of the typical, very stereotypical North American superhero mold. And I think it fits that very nicely and expands upon it.
I think with the show getting darker, the general consensus I've seemed to imply from what people have told me is that it's along the lines of like Harry Potter getting darker.
Oh, well, that would be perfectly fine.
Yeah, it's not jumping straight to Berserk.
But I guess moving on, Space Patrol Luluco.
And silence.
Trigger made a fan fiction about themselves.
That's a great way of describing it.
That's basically... there was an episode where she sat down and for 7 minutes had a heart-to-heart talk with Inferno Cop in hell. Like, the sheer absurdity that went on in the show is amazing, and if you're a fan of Trigger's other works, you probably greatly enjoyed this. If you aren't, then there's probably not much here for you. So, it's one of those. This was for... This was fan service, and I don't mean, you know, I don't mean her mom. I mean the whole show was just straight, hey, you like the stuff we've made, here's all the stuff we've made, because we have leftover budget.
The thing that I dropped it mid-season around the Kill la Kill episode, and I dropped it mainly because I really didn't like how much pander it had.
And it was just pander. That the entire show was just pander, and it's just one of those things, some people aren't going to like that. But if you can enjoy it, something like that, very, you know, tongue-in-cheek style, we know you like what we made, here's these characters returning in ridiculous scenarios, then it was perfectly fine for what it was.
I liked it a lot. I thought it was really fun. I liked the length, that it was a short. Pacing was great. I liked the animation style. It was, you know, really fun dessert anime.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
Yeah, it was fun, and I thought the ending was pretty clever as well, how they spun that. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure I would want, you know, a season two of Space Patrol Luluco,
or at another least not year for a of Space while. Patrol Luluco. I want at least four more original Trigger animes before we get Luluco season 2, so that she can go through the other Trigger anime worlds.
There you go.
It's kind of like how Clamp does their occasional music videos with all their series, but they only do it like every 10 years or so.
Right, and I would be perfectly fine with every 5 years we get another season of Luluco where she just explores the last, you know, few shows that have gone on. I think that would be pretty fun, honestly. So yeah, I like Luluco. I gave it a 7. I thought it was funny and was a good, you know, nice fan service-y 8-minute long show every week for somebody who was a fan of Trigger's other work.
Yeah, but Trigger actually had another series this season, another original series called Kiznaiver, which was okay.
Now, I only watched the first six episodes of this, so I can't judge anything past the halfway point.
I mean, it does have some really good scenes in the later episodes, but yeah, it's largely a lot of the same stuff going on.
Okay, so here's my thoughts on Kiznaiver. You can tell they put God, their animation staff there at Trigger is just godly. This show looks utterly fantastic. You know, it was on par with like the best of Madhouse and people like that.
This show looked
amazing. It sounded amazing, as you expect from the guys who do, let's face it, the best sound design in anime by a large margin. But just the very first episode, you had what felt like a solid 10 minutes of that Kudori bitch just talking to them about nothing.
Yeah.
And then, like, making the stupid comparisons to the Seven Deadly Sins that made absolutely no sense and were completely pointless, just chinibi bullshit. Like, I sat there and I went, and at the time, a few people were telling me, wow, did you watch episode one of Kiznaiver? It was so great. And I went back to him, I'm like, were you fucking high? I just watched some blue-haired bitch just explain what would amount to a season's worth of premise to me, and then just throw on a bunch of excessive bullshit that just muddled what would otherwise be a really strong concept, which is people linked together that feel each other's pain and have to learn to work with that. That's a really strong concept. And they just buried it under crap. So from the get-go, it left a bad taste in my mouth. And by time I left off, it had definitely gotten better. I'd gotten a better feel for some of the characters. It wasn't focusing on the shit that made me so pissed in the first episode. But it still wasn't to the point where I was like eagerly hungry to watch the next episode like I was, say, JoJo or ReZero.
Yeah, they definitely never really go back to any of the stuff they mentioned in the first episode, like with
good.
Which is good because that was kind of nonsense.
Totally unnecessary bullshit.
Yeah, the writing in the show, it kind of reminds me of Gatchaman Crowd's Insight, where there's some genuinely interesting stuff there, but it's just muddled on a lot of really crappy writing here and there.
It felt like they were trying really, really hard to make this deep, deep, meaningful show.
Yeah. And they
were throwing so much stuff of it, they lost track of their own plot lines that they left, or they started something and didn't really finish it, or
which
got
is
back
really
to it
weird
in a half-assed way. It almost felt like they were trying so hard to produce this anime masterpiece that they got lost totally in the weeds.
Yeah.
Space Patrol Luluco, they just did this, you know what, here's the thing, and it was just effortless and fun. And
which is
because they tried so hard, it didn't come together.
Right, yeah. No, I would completely agree. As far as I got was that they just felt like they were so intent on how they got to their final destination, they forgot where they were even going.
Yeah, it definitely felt like it needed to go at least another couple of once-throughs in the revision process.
Mm-hmm. It is really weird when you consider it. With Trigger, you know, if you go back to the Gainax days with, you know, that main team and staff and stuff, and you consider the type of really deep shows these guys made with out of stupid crap. And then here you get the opposite. You get something that came out and was supposed to be deep and meaningful, and it turned into stupid crap.
Yeah, and
it feels like they're the type who just, I don't want to say do better when they don't try, but do better when they're not trying to take themselves too seriously.
Yeah.
And understand that you can make art and have fun at the same time.
Yeah, that definitely feels like the premise for Trigger, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when they're making something that's dumb, they make it really well, but...
And they actually add a level of depth and intelligence and thought and theme to it, which Kiznaiver's, all of that just felt buried under other garbage.
Yeah, like I mentioned, there are some really good scenes later on, but the ending, it's basically, we're friends now. Friendship saved us all, basically.
Yay!
Well, this is, I think, where the show really falls apart. If the premise is, you know, we would all get along better if we could really empathize and understand each other and understand each other's pain more, then we would be a happier, healthier society.
Yeah.
Fine premise. If the answer is we need to make a multi-billion-dollar city and put 10, 15 random kids in it and force them through this bizarre operation so that they then become... It's just so overcomplicated.
Right?
It doesn't work anymore. Yeah. So at some point, it's like, you never thought of other ways to teach kids empathy rather than go that direction? By the time you get to that revelation, it's like, okay, you've completely, you know, missed the boat on this on every single level. Not to mention that anybody would be okay with doing that to children.
This wasn't the typical trigger that we've come to know and love for their very, I would almost say, like, Rick and Morty-esque seemingly thought process, where they just probably sit around and think up stupid, bizarre shit and then find a way to make it intelligent.
Yeah.
Instead, they were trying to be intelligent and then turned into stupid, bizarre shit that wasn't.
Yeah, it crumbled and fell apart under its own weight. It had a lot of good stuff going on. Like, it looked fantastic, and I think some people were really swept up by some of the characters were in the show.
Yeah, and there were a lot of enjoyable personalities going on. And as sounds like I'm ragging on those first six episodes, apart from the first one, I ended up, you know, pretty much enjoying myself when I was watching it. It didn't turn into a grind. The first episode was definitely the weakest of the six I watched. Right now, halfway through, I'd probably give it about a 7. It's still a enjoyable show. I'm not sitting here telling you, oh, no, get it away from me. And maybe it gets worse later on or something. But with the production values and the, you know, the dialogue and the character portrayals and everything going on, I think it definitely makes up for having kind of a nonsensical plot.
Yeah, it collapsed under its own weight. They were trying too hard to make the anime of the season and the one that we'd be talking about for generations. Whereas, you know, Space Patrol Luluco was like, fuck it, ice cream, everyone! And ice cream! And, you know, everybody happy.
And the crazy thing is, out of the two, general consensus seems to be Luluco was the better one that's going to be more fondly remembered.
Yep.
That's the general
When you consider that's just kind of nutty to think about that. Yeah, because that was classic Trigger. That was them just deciding to have fun and made something decently unique and intelligent by doing so.
Yeah. But anything else about Kiznaiver?
Nope.
No.
All right. So I'm the only one who watched it, but Tonkatsu DJ Agetarou. That's his name at the end, but I'm not sure if I pronounced it right. Oh, but oh well.
So, all right, so give your best sales pitch. Why should I watch the show, or why should I not watch the show?
So it's a comedy about a guy who is working, who decides to become a DJ and a tonkatsu, basically basically to take up the art of making tonkatsu in his dad's restaurant. And it's, the art style, it kind of reminds me of the one ping pong anime.
Okay.
Just the way it's designed. It's got a very, I'm not quite sure how to describe it, but a very unique art style. In some ways, it kind of reminds me of, you know, like the old Beavis and Butthead kind of style.
That's a weird direction for an anime to go.
Yeah, it looks very weird, and just the way it's animated is so weirdly interesting but intriguing at the same time.
Yeah, no, it doesn't sound bad. It just sounds weird.
It's very weird. But the thing that I love so much about it is definitely the soundtrack. They have so many good tracks on it. Every character that they sort of introduce kind of has their own sort of theme song when they're actually DJing. Mm-hmm. And it just... this music is just so good. I'm not entirely sure if there was a specific who the specific composer was, but he did a really good job for that show. And it honestly, out of all the shows I watched this season, it definitely had one of the best soundtracks. So if you really like hip hop and other tracks along those lines, it has a lot of great music. But
all right.
That's about
so
myself.
On a scale of 1 to 10, where would you rate it?
Probably a 7.5. Like, it was extremely entertaining. I wouldn't really put it on the, oh my god, this is one of the best anime out there. But it was definitely a really enjoyable show for the season. If you just want to
checking out, if you have a little bit of spare time,
pretty much.
And between shows.
And if I remember right, it's only like half 12 minutes an episode, so it's not even a full half hour investment.
Oh, that's definitely a bonus.
But, you know, that's pretty much all I have to say about it. It's easily one of the best soundtracks this season. But moving on to Tanaka-kun is Always Listless, which honestly is one of my personal favorite series of the season.
This to me was an incredibly intelligent show that kind of knew from the beginning where its humor was going and set out to center every facet of the show around that. It developed some really, really fun characters, and by the end, I felt it was really hitting its stride and really wished there was more of it.
Yeah, it's... I occasionally compare it to Know the Kikun, even though Know the Kikun is definitely the better of the shows, but it definitely had a lot of the similar charms of
Know the Kikun. No, I will 100% agree with that. It was very much in line with Nozaki's character-centric and interaction-centric humor basis.
Yeah. It was also really great anime for Saturdays because Saturdays I almost always wanted to do absolutely nothing, and this was a show comedy is entirely centered around a character who just wants to be lazy.
It was a character with the opposite of a main character complex. He wanted the absolutely nothing to do with being in the limelight. He just wanted to be in the background and sleep.
He wanted to be a faceless character in the background, basically.
Right. It was the opposite of a main character complex.
Yes. And it had a lot of really good supporting casts.
Oh, very strong.
Like, crap, I can't remember their names off the top of my head because I didn't write them down, but,
Ota, Tarashi.
Yeah, Ota. Ota is so good.
Oh, what's the energetic little girl's name who's always bouncing off the wall?
So for me, this is an interesting show in the sense that I actually did not get the first episode.
Miyano, it's Miyano.
Yeah, Miyano.
And I understand that the show really needs a little while to get going.
It takes about 3-4 episodes to start hitting itself.
Yeah.
Yeah, typically like when I decide to not follow an anime for the season, and generally I try to watch at least the first episode of everything, I look back and read the comments and say, oh, it seems like I've made a good decision. This is the one that I keep hearing brought up repeatedly, that it's actually one that should be checked out, and it's one that I keep kind of regretting that I didn't stick with it.
It's one of the tenets of the Madoka rule. Give everything that's not absolutely terrible 3 episodes.
Yeah,
just too many shows, especially this last season, that's where that was just like not happening.
Yeah, I can't fault anybody this season because I had to drop so much that wasn't terrible.
Yeah,
a lot didn't get its Madoka rule out of me, but that was because of schedule, not because of the show.
Yeah, generally, I think you're right, though. You need the first one to just kind of introduce the premise, introduce some of the characters, and they need a little bit of time to get, you know, the plot moving. And if the plot isn't moving by episode 3, that's probably not going to go anywhere.
Right.
Or you have enough of a sense of, okay, I see where this is going, and I'm really not interested.
I can name
that's fine.
One show that ended up really good without being good in the first 3 episodes, and that's Desert Punk, which took... Episode 5 was the first one that wasn't terrible. every other show I've watched within the first 3 episodes, you've got a pretty good idea of what's going on.
Yeah. Well, me personally, I really loved the first episode, but a lot of the humor was really jiving with me and the entire feel of the character. But I definitely heard a number of people who didn't quite get into it until they introduced Miyano, and maybe even after that.
Yeah, when we started getting to Miyano, and I think it was the episode with Shiraichi when I really fell in love with the show.
Yeah.
That was the one that really, you know, got me laughing, and I just really identified with her and, you know, really enjoyed the show from that point forward.
Well, Miyano she's a really good contrast with Tanaka-kun. Just how she's completely energetic, and he's completely tired and never wants to do much, and you basically can't get away from Miyano. You can't tell her no. And he basically said that, like, as soon as the third time he told her no, is like, he told Oda no. She's just going to keep going on. It's more likely just to take. It's going to take less energy if we just allow her to observe us.
Yeah.
And it sounds like from the premise, this might be a show that culturally packs an even bigger punch in Japan, since, you know, every other episode, every other show, you hear somebody saying, hey, let's do our best, and he seems to be sort of the antithesis of that.
Very much and so.
In a society where it's frowned upon if you're not a try-hard worker ant, for him to be, okay, well, I'm just not going to do anything, and that to be the entire premise, I think makes him probably an even more winning character and even winning humorous premise in Japan.
Yeah.
Whereas I'm perfectly comfortable just being completely listless on the couch, so I didn't want to see myself reflected.
It was too real.
Yes, it's too real. I know exactly what you go through. That's not funny. That's my Saturday.
It's kind of like how some people can't watch Watamote because they relate far too much to
right.
Yeah, I've heard that criticism.
I haven't
too.
Watched Watamote, but I've just heard the horror stories, and I know it's on my docket.
It's so good, but yeah, if you relate far too much to her, you will feel absolute pain.
Yeah, it's you laugh and then you kind of stop laughing. And, oh, the realness, it hurts. But I think it's intentionally designed that way. So I liked Watamote, but you know we're getting off topic.
Watamote season 2.
When? I need more pain. I need to feel that pain. Anything else to say about Tanaka-kun?
Not really. I think I covered what I thought about it. Damn good show. I gave it a 7, but absolute upper. I contemplated that one for a long time, which spot it deserved to be in.
Yeah, it definitely hit.
It was right there, the borderline.
It definitely hit an 8 to me, but yeah, it was really good.
I mean, if anything, just as a general thought, I think anime comedy is really, really hard.
It's very
repetitive, tired premises that we've seen over and over again. They just put, you know, a different girl, a different layer of paint on it, slightly variation of, you know, who the main character is and where they come from. But to have a truly fresh, new take on something is so exceedingly rare.
Yeah, and this definitely was that. And I definitely give it props for that. And do keep in mind when I say this is I gave it a high 7 instead of an 8. The comedies that rank in the 8 range for me are Gekken Shoujo, Nozaki-kun, Saikano, Konosuba, like pretty top of the line stuff. So this is just a hair below that.
So now Mark is going to talk about the best comedy of the season, The Lost Village, also known as Mayoiga.
Mayoiga.
Yeah, so one thing I really felt we needed to keep this one on the list is whenever I was reading any Twitter, this seemed to be the show where you would fall in one of two camps. You would either say this is the most inspired, brilliant, genius comedy that you have ever seen, or this is the biggest piece of garbage anime that could possibly exist. And there isn't really much in between. I've seen nobody who said, well, you know, I appreciated it for these elements, but, you know, I kind of give it a solid 7. It's like you either hated it or you loved it, and if you loved it, it was for reasons that are completely outside my realm of understanding.
Yeah.
Because I honestly did not follow the comedic elements or that this was intentionally meant to be funny. There were some parts of it that were just ridiculous. All of the characters are trying to escape their, you know, mundane, humdrum, problem-filled lives. And one of the characters wanted to, I think, join the army or the police, and he wasn't tall enough. So for some reason, he had the idea that he should have a silicone implant put under his scalp to give himself the extra, you know, 2 inches that he needed to make the required height requirement. So the phantom that chases him around in the Lost Village is a gigantic, oversized breast implant. I can see.
Okay, suddenly I'm far more interested in the show. So
I can see if it was all this, it would be great. However, then you have another character introduced whose single line is, you know, kill them or destroy them or harm them. And her backstory is that her mom was a single mom, and in order to make ends meet, she is essentially being repeatedly visited and raped by a local monk who physically abuses her, also verbally and physically abuses the child. And when you put those two elements together, you really have a hard time saying, I think this is, you know, satire.
Yeah, it's hard to laugh at that.
Yeah, it's like it really, it, you know, the laughter just really kind of gets lost. And another character is being, she's kind of picking on her friends, so they turn against her and, you know, tie her to a pole underneath a wasp nest and keep shooting away at that wasp nest to eventually, you know, have the wasp attack her. Again, also not, you know, screechingly belly laugh funny. And because it was living with both feet in both of these worlds, the utter ridiculousness of certain visual elements and then the other very, very serious parts of it, that really made you think, like, okay, maybe this is, you know, somewhat of a ghost story. It just really didn't come together at all on any kind of level.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like. The way you're describing it, it sounds like it was just completely all over the place.
Totally all over the place. And I could see, you know, where you can say, you know, maybe this is just so far off that it's meant to be funny. But there were so many elements of it that just felt like poor execution that I just couldn't buy into the idea that this was intentionally set up that way. And that's why I was really struggling, and that's why I'm at least firmly in the camp of, you know, this is terrible. I understand the idea of spoofs. We have it over here with a series of scary movies, which like to spoof and harpoon certain genres of horror.
We had a really damn good spoof anime just last season in Konosuba.
Yes, but then, you know, it's pretty clear what it is, and it doesn't really, you know, deviate from that.
Konosuba had a whole episode where they essentially beat up and robbed Kirito. Like, it was very obvious what that show was. You know, like, the most subtle spoofing you get would be, like, Monster Musume, where it's still in its genre, but the main character doesn't even have a name. Like,
right.
Any less than that, and you're really getting out of spoof character. You know,
yes, and it never really left that ridiculousness as far as Monster Musume was concerned. He never had, you know, and he was the child, and his mom died while he was only 5 years old.
Dude, if they gave the freaking main character of Monster Musume a super tragic backstory...
And like... that's what The Lost Village did constantly. So I was really, really struggling with this show. And I actually ended up finishing watching it, and I'm still, you know, scratching my head what the hell they were trying to accomplish. And because it's so hard to really figure out what they were trying to accomplish, I think it fails on that level completely. Ta-da!
Ta-da.
But you can go back and watch at least the episode where the one guy is being chased around by a gigantic oversized breast implant.
I think I will do that. I will take you up on that offer.
But
I mean, it was definitely an interesting watch. It always kept you kind of guessing where is this going to go
and
next.
It exists.
But I was initially I thought this was going to be like this teen slasher horror film. You put a bunch of idiots, and for starters, the cast of characters was way too large. So,
oh yeah, I saw
know,
that from episode
30
one,
characters like, in
for 12 episodes
like that. You know, you're gonna expect them to, you know, fall and die left and right. I thought this was like, you know, you sent the teenagers into the zombie forest and watch them get horribly maimed, and I was ready for that, but it never got there.
Well, I guess moving on, you guys can talk about life, which both of you really loved.
Yes, from the most bewildering anime, the most head-scratching show, to the one that I surprisingly loved more than anything else that came out last season.
I heard somebody describe Flying Witch as, what if they just animated a ray of sunshine? And I think that's actually pretty damn accurate. This is a show where in most episodes, absolutely nothing happens.
Well, nothing of consequence.
Yeah.
Like they go
There's
to the restaurant.
Plot here. Like, there's no progression. They go out, they meet some interesting people. Sometimes they just do things as mundane as there was a whole episode where he just followed their cat around town. And the cat didn't do anything particularly interesting. They just followed their cat. And just the level of mundane nothing that could go on in the show was staggering, and yet you'd still come away with a huge smile on your face and be like, I don't know what the hell I just watched, but I super loved it.
Yeah, it's super charming. The best way I could describe it, it's like, imagine Harry Potter, but there's no Voldemort. So all you have is, you know, the letters that fly and talk, and the cars that fly, and, you know, the magic of the ceiling that transforms itself, and people flying around, and but all really relatively, you know, small tastes of what the world of witches is like. These are not the witches that are going to, you know, band together and protect the world from some horrendous evil. These are just, you know, witches going about doing their witchy thing.
Witches just exist. They're pretty much normal people. They can just fly on broomsticks and cast some weird spells.
Witches are people too.
And now every once in a while there was a hilarious scene in this show. Like, there was a few times I laughed my ass off, but even that wasn't super common. It's just...
The show had just perfect timing. Perfect comedic timing in every regard.
This show was just one of those really weird, rare ones where you're just going to... I like to call it the Umaru category, where it's one of those shows that there's nothing objectively amazing about it, but some people are just going to adore it, and other people will completely just be like, why do people like this? It is the most... Like, I should just rename it the Flying Witch scenario, because Umaru did not encroach on this level of, if your mileage will vary ridiculously. You're going to go 5 miles or 500 with the show. This is not for everybody in the most drastic of terms I can put it.
Yep, and I love that it came out on the weekend. This was like the perfect show to just kind of kick back and watch. It's like being a muggle visiting Diagon Alley. Just great, like a little taste of magic here and there, but, you know, nothing earth-shattering, but they would really take you on this little bit of a journey, and then at the end of it, just leave you.
Yeah, it's definitely, it sounds like kind of how Tanaka-kun was for me, where it's just this show I can enjoy on the weekend and just
There was actually a lot of similarity between Tanaka-kun and the show in terms of just its general, like, comedic pacing and how it felt. But Tanaka, there was a lot more going on. Which is weird to say, because there's not a lot going on in Tanaka, right? There's a lot more going on in Tanaka than there... Like, each character has their own sort of subplot and stuff going on in Tanaka. And, like, they're interacting and stuff in interesting ways. That's not happening in Flying Witch. There's nobody has a crush on anybody. Nope. You know, nobody's sister is trying to get rid of their best friend. You know, there's nothing.
It doesn't become a harem show for the male character. The male character is just there.
There's nothing happening. It's just enjoyable. It's just cute. It's the most bizarre thing I've seen in a long ass time, but it's just fucking good.
Yeah, it's just utterly charming. And the characters are utterly charming. You watch them for 11 episodes, and you never get tired of them, and they never get grating or rub you the wrong way. Mm-hmm. It's like, get on with it, or, you know, why aren't you mastering this already?
Which is weird, because, like you said, there's in one episode you literally watch butter melting for a full minute. And there's another episode where it's 20 minutes of them following around their cat. And
planting a garden.
Yeah. He chases that freaking pheasant for like 3 minutes. Yep. It's unbelievable, like, just how little they had to do in this show, and it's still this good. This, like I said, goes right into the Umaru zone for me, where, you know what, if you liked Umaru and if you like the Gashikashi, you're probably like this. It's the same way of not much actually happens. It's not laugh out loud hilarious for most of it, but it's just going to leave you walking away with a smile on your face.
Yeah, I like Dagashikashi with the nerding out about candy, but it might have had just a little bit too much fan service or
that's completely subjective.
Flying Witch has none of that.
Yeah, there's no fan service or anything like that in Flying Witch.
Anything else to say about Flying Witch?
Check it out. It's my favorite show of the season.
It's unique enough that... Give it an episode. If you like that episode, you'll like the rest of it. If you didn't like that episode, you'll feel the same way about the rest. It's a one-episode investment for something that could be really good.
Mm-hmm. All right. So that's pretty much all the shows we were wanting to talk about from the season. So now, what are our overall thoughts on the season? How about you, Mark?
I thought this season was interesting for me in the sense that it offered just a vast number of good shows where I had a hard time dropping them midway through. I mean, I think we kind of just scratched the surface of all the shows I ended up watching. But all in all, there wasn't really one where I would say, you know, this is the one that 2 years from now, I'm still going to tell somebody, you know, you got to go back and you got to catch that show. So we just talked about Flying Witch. I really hope we get to see more of that. I thought it was fantastic. But it wasn't really a show of, you know, the level of Rakugo or Shirobako, where I still can't stop talking about it. A show like Bakuan or, you know, Space Patrol Luluco or, you know, Kiznaiver, in 2 years, we probably may not be talking about that at all.
I imagine.
Kabanari of the Iron Fortress, you know, it was
great.
Yeah, Kabanari felt like a one-note show where it won't be remembered like...
It was fun while you watched it. You're not going to be talking about it.
This was like the, you know, the... what is it? The Independence Day of the summer. It's like, happened, and we saw it, and we had popcorn, and we had a good time, and that's it.
That's exactly what it is. You're 100% right.
And that's how I think most of the shows this summer felt. There were a lot of them, but none of them are really going to stick with me where I'm going to say, you know, that's the one. You really got to go back and make sure you catch that one because it was just so good.
Yeah, me personally, I feel like this season was sort of middle of the road where we've had a lot worse seasons, and this season was so much better than winter season, I felt like. Winter, I had like one show in the 8, and the rest were either 7s or 6s, and I wasn't really watching that many shows to begin with. But it's not like the best season we had in quite a while. Which, to be fair, I think the last really good season was at least half a year ago or so, maybe.
I wouldn't necessarily go that far, but it was like going to a big all-you-can-eat buffet. There was a lot, and you were sure to find something. But you're probably not going to go home and say, boy, I really enjoyed that, you know, fried chicken at that
buffet. This definitely wasn't, you know, winter 2015, but it also wasn't summer 2015. It was somewhere in the middle.
It wasn't like we had a One Punch Man series like we did a few seasons ago where One Punch Man was great. The rest of the season kind of sucked, at least in my personal opinion. You can disagree or agree with that however you like. But this season had a lot of really solid shows and not too many really bad ones, I felt.
Yeah, it's like a lot of Bs.
Yeah.
A lot of 7s out of 10, 8s out of 10.
This is a weird one for me just because there was so much I had to drop for personal reasons. This season, none because I just... Well, there were a couple I dropped because it was just bad, but there was very little where I would, you know, was watching it and just went, you know, I don't feel like watching the rest of this. Just the weird thing for me is that I feel like the numbers I have ranked, like in this, I have 1-8 and then a bunch of 7s and then a couple like lower than that. I feel like that's kind of misrepresentative of the overall quality of the season, because in my opinion, the two best shows are continuing. So I enjoyed the season a lot more than the numbers suggest. But, you know, in terms of that 7 and 8 range, this was a damn good stable of 7s with, you know, stuff like Flying Witch and Tanaka-kun, and shows that I greatly enjoyed and will continue suggesting to people in the future.
Go
ahead.
I definitely felt like this season was definitely a 7 out of 10 if you rounded it all.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah, I think it's interesting that you pointed that out when you really par it down to the shows that only ran for the duration of the season. It's kind of, you know...
Without JoJo ReZero, the season's very middle of the road. But I enjoyed it on par of like
JoJo
an
right
eight
now
season.
Is probably the best JoJo of all the four.
This is my favorite JoJo so far, and ReZero's really strong. So... I've enjoyed the hell out of the season. It's just that I can't include the two best shows in that, you know, in the numbers.
Yeah,
and ReZero is also kind of all over the place, but because it is so all over the place, that's a show that I think for a while we're going to be talking about. Like, remember that wacky ReZero?
It needs to be all over the place, though. Like, that's part of how it's formulating itself.
Yeah, I'm
any really show that any show that messes with the time continuum kind of has to be all over the place. Remember the first few episodes of Steins Gate?
Hell yeah.
Steins Gate took forever to get started, though.
I don't think so. I enjoyed it from episode one, but it was all over the place.
I definitely felt like episode one of Steins Gate didn't quite get you in there until you definitely needed at least three for most people.
It just depends who you are.
Yeah.
But if you're one of those people who wants to know exactly what's going on from the get-go, then yeah, you need a few for Steins Gate. If you're one of the people like me who, if something's just fucking weird, you're interested in it, then episode one's perfectly fine.
And to be fair, episode one of Steins Gate is just so much better on the second time through because you get to point to so many things and understand what's going on.
Yeah.
Yeah. But any other thoughts on the season?
Not really.
Watch Flying Witch. And watch JoJo. If you have solid JoJo after JoJo 3.
Oh man, if you're not watching JoJo by now, you need to watch JoJo.
Thought it was solid, enjoyed it. Really looking forward to what comes next.
Yeah. So now let's move on to what we're excited for the current season, which is summer 2016.
JoJo!
Well, yeah, I mean JoJo.
That's so much, though.
Yeah. So I guess I'll go start it off with Sweetness and Lightning.
Yay!
I am a huge fan of the manga, so that is a slight bias, but Sweetness and Lightning is so good. So good.
It's on my list, so I'm going to watch it. I have, to put it out there, I have not had time to sit down and watch episode one of any of the season shows, so my opinion on anything that's not a continuation is purely, I thought that sounded cool from the synopsis, or people told me that sounded cool. So that's where Sweetness and Lightning is for me. You guys have been going on about it, so I threw it on there.
Yeah, it's so sweet. The first episode will probably give you early onset diabetes.
Well, I like Flying Witch, so I'll probably enjoy
it. It's really, really cute. The only, and I haven't read the manga at all, the only apprehension I have is I'm really, really hoping it doesn't lead into a relationship between the dad and the high schooler.
It doesn't go there. It strays away from that later on. It slightly veers towards it, but then veers far away.
Thank God. Because that would have just really burned all the goodwill bridges that build up.
Yeah, it definitely veers more towards friendship and just helping him out with his kid.
Excellent. Sort of. I was hoping that's the direction it would take.
I mean, it could not. I will warn you, it will slightly veer towards that at the beginning, though.
And that's okay, because given the scenario, without giving too much away,
it grazes the passenger door but doesn't cause a wreck.
Yeah. Yeah, and given the premise, it makes perfect sense that it has to be addressed. It would be weird to not, address it at all. I just didn't want to see the show make it about that. That would have just been horrendous.
It's definitely more about him and his daughter's relationship more than him and his student's relationship.
So he's not looking for his, new waifu in the course of the show.
Very not.
Thank God. Okay, then I will wholeheartedly recommend Sweetness and Lightning as an ongoing watch.
Yeah, and let's see what else. 91 Days is interesting. I'm not sure if I'm going to stick with it or not. I've watched the first episode. I'm intrigued, but it doesn't quite seem like the show I tend to veer towards.
Yeah, to me this is like the Joker game of this season. Like, you have to like that period drama. And
I
this
mean,
is,
I,
you know, prohibition area, mafia, and alcohol making, and
which
crime.
I mean,
which could be great.
I love Bakano, but this, if you're going in expecting Bakano, don't.
Yeah, I haven't watched Bakano, so that's not why I'm on board, but the setting sounded super interesting, so I'm definitely giving it a watch and looking forward to it.
And it's got fantastic art so far. I thought that really stood out. It looks great. It almost looks like a movie from that time period. It really has that feel.
So. Yeah. And I have no idea what else Studio Shuka has done before. On other shows, didn't want that. Honda-kun. I really love Barakamon. I hate Honda-kun so much. It is such a... It's not the worst offshoot. I mean, you can never be worse than Soul Eater Not was, but it's so bad. Just what the fuck is going on here?
I have nothing to add. I watched the first episode, it didn't stick at all, and I'm not going to keep going.
No, if you want a great series, watch Barakamon. Avoid Honda-kun. At least from the first episode. I might check out the second one just to see if it's continuation of that what the fuck that was going on in the first, but no. let's see, what else?
Food Wars Season 2. Wars. That's the one I'm on.
Yay, more Food Wars.
I adored Food Wars Season 1. I gave it a 9 out of 10. And, haven't gotten around to watch the first episode of Season 2 yet, but I really doubt that I'm going to like it less.
It's so good, and the way they set it up, it's basically just continuing off of what Season 1 was.
Perfect. That's all I want.
Yep.
I said this is the spiritual successor to Ice Shield 21. It's just food instead of football, and if that premise continues, I am not disappointed in the least.
The second show of the season, and this is not giving anything away really, in the battle of the food wars, when it gets to the dramatic conclusion, the food turns into stands. I will leave it there.
Yes.
Oh, man. Oh, that's pretty great. Food stands. Hey, JoJo had that too.
It did.
JoJo. Speaking of JoJo, season 4 is really good, and that's continuing.
Yeah.
ReZero is really good, and that's continuing. So there's some good looking stuff this season. You know what doesn't look good? A show that I am very happy to put on the docket. I had to drop 100 last season because I just didn't have the time to keep up with something obviously god awful, even though it was funny. This season, my replacement is called Ska Red Riders Zex, spelled X E C H. Capital S. And boy, the synopsis sounded like the most stupid garbage ever, and from what I hear about episode 1, I will not be disappointed.
Well, you know what really looks bad? Berserk 2016.
Oh, boy! Oh! Oh! Oh,
my eyes are bleeding just from watching one episode of that CGI.
It looks like a PS2 game.
It looks worse than that. It looks like a sophisticated PS1 game.
It looks like the original build of King of the Fighters 14.
It probably is.
It probably is. That's where those assets went. SNK presents Berserk.
But it does kind of suck because that's a well-liked series, and it just looks awful, especially when you compare it to like the original 1999 or so. Or was it 95 anime?
A long time ago, and there's no excuse for something made in 2016 to look worse.
Yeah. And even by CGI standards, I've seen some really good CGI shows like Ubiki, Baranki, and
Ultimate Blade Works. For that matter, the Japanese have done damn good work on that in video games, too.
Yeah.
So it's not like they don't know how to do good CG over there.
Yeah, it's very clearly looks like they didn't put too much budget.
Budget as fuck.
Yeah. But I think that's pretty much all the shows I've watched so far, at least the first episodes of. Shows I'm still excited for, definitely Mob Psycho 100.
Because One Punch Man's brilliant, and apparently this is the one he tries on. I am apprehensive because it's Bones, and these days you have to be apprehensive because you never know what Bones is going to show up. So I'm just really hoping for Boku no Hero Academia and not Blood Bowl K Battlefront or Concrete Revolutio.
Yeah.
Because obviously this is very strong source material. Very strong source material, so I really hope they don't tank it.
Yeah. And the other and the one show I'm watching this season for the pure purposes of hate watching, Time Travel Girl, because I need to see what Animu Benjamin Franklin looks like.
God, which one is? Maybe I have under. That sounds familiar. I think I put it on the docket to watch, but
it's Time Travel Shoujo on the on anime list, but it's on Funimation. And it's Time Travel Girl there. Huh. And basically, it's the main character going back in time and meeting famous scientists, including, like I mentioned,
Edison
and Graham
yeah,
Bell.
Yeah, I definitely saw it. I think that's on my docket to watch, too.
It's so badly written and terrible, but I don't expect anything different. I need to watch it just to see what Animu Benjamin Franklin looks like. I need this.
JJ says as he shoves the dirty needle into his arm. The dirty needle labeled bad anime that I have been consistently using for 3 years now.
Well, I kind
I
of
can't.
Can be.
There
can't.
Might be traces of Danmachi left in there. You better be careful.
I mean, I did use it before you back in the days of Momokyon Sword and Hime
just,
Gojo.
Just know it hasn't been washed since.
Okay, that's good. I still need that disease in there. But what else?
Madhouse has a show out this season that it didn't sound particularly interesting, but I threw it on just because it's Madhouse.
Alderman, but it doesn't look that good.
I'll give any Madhouse show a try.
Yeah.
Because there's been terrible sounding premises that ended up great from them. So, you know, there's also shows that I've dropped after three episodes from them, like Princess Stride, just because I said this isn't my thing. But it's like they've at least earned, like, just like Trigger, always at least give them a chance.
Yeah.
And I find sometimes the premise itself is not a good indicator of the show you end up getting.
Yeah.
So I try to really catch as many first episodes as I can, unless it's readily apparent that it's not going to be anything good.
I think I'm going to hold back on it and just wait until I hear what people say about it.
So the ones I'm really looking forward to are Orange. I've heard
a lot of good things about that one so far.
The first two episodes have been great. So I've really loved it. It's going to be interesting to see how they can hold up, because I understand they're already running into production issues and timing issues, so we'll see if they can really maintain the quality of animation.
Here's hoping they don't have a just completely trash episode where the animation is completely undone.
Episode 9 is just people in a room talking.
So other shows that I've really enjoyed seeing so far are Anmanshu, if I probably horribly mispronounced that. It's about a very outgoing scuba diving high school girl and a very shy, socially awkward, anxious high school girl. But some of the animation reduces their facial expressions to that they almost look like Muppets. But the show itself is...
That's Konosuba really backgrounds going on.
A little bit, yes. But the show itself seems to be really, really sweet and really right on the money.
I've heard some mixed stuff from people where I've heard some people really love it and some people just go, what the fuck, and kind of drop it.
It's probably, that's probably a really fair assessment. So if that's, your cup of tea, you're really going to like it. And if
are you
not,
saying this is an Umaru zone, or?
No, because it plays it a lot more seriously than Umaru. Umaru was like a ridiculous gift factory, but this
well,
is not.
Well, by that I mean a show like Umaru Flying Witch, where it's very, there's nothing
more
that you can
Flying
specify
Witch.
What's great, but I put those in the same category. There's nothing here that you can specify as a reason it's great, you just know you really liked it.
Yeah. Then the other show I really liked was the cheer team. I'm looking at the Japanese
was
title.
Was it Days?
Cheer Danshi? No, Days is the soccer anime, which is terrible. but the male cheer team has some really good comedy timing. So if you're just itching for a sports anime with boys, that'll fill your need.
It's been too long since Kuroko Basketball.
Yeah, it's not quite that.
It's been too long since TQ.
And then Taboo Tattoo seems to be just like ridiculously
it's been way too long
stupid,
since
but in a good way, ridiculously stupid. So I'm probably going to stick that one out for a couple of episodes. Real Life has released in its entirety, and I watched that last week.
I remember talking about Adam at the end of the Know the Key episode on that one.
Yeah.
Isn't that basically 17 again, the anime?
I think it's a little bit more depth to that, because the main character doesn't really go off on, you know, hey, let's have fun with high school girls. And the supporting
characters... That'd be a very different type of show.
Yeah, and the supporting characters really have a lot of character development going on for it. So what seemed like a kind of a stupid premise ended up being surprisingly rich in drama and character development. It starts out as very comedy and then gradually shifts more and more into a dramatic area. So I really, really liked it. It's especially a good binge watch.
Well, I mean, you can actually binge watch it now.
Yes. They released, Crunchyroll released all 13 episodes. All at once. So I have at it. And one that I watched yesterday, Planetarian, that looks pretty interesting.
Yeah, I watched, you know, I played the VN for that and just cried my fucking eyes out, so I'm ready for more pain. That's the good thing from Key I've experienced, because everything else has been meh.
Well, if you're a huge Key fan, you're always going to jump on Key shows.
I'm not, but I still loved Planetarian, so I'm definitely going to watch this and probably enjoy it and probably cry a lot.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that, but I'm Orange will fill that gap for you too. The
I'm
one
gonna cry a lot with Orange?
Yeah. the one anime that so far has been the absolute stinker is Hybrid Heart Magias Academy.
Well, that name already sounds like it's terrible.
I threw this on my docket because I'm like, wow, this looks right in the vein of like Triage X and Valkyrie Drive.
And, that's bad.
You know, and yeah, which in that place, what the fuck do you expect? It's basically porn. It's softcore porn. It's Why do you expect anything else?
Okay, scratch the soft, and then you have it. Word is already that several stations in Japan have dropped the show after the first airing.
That. Okay, well then straight up, it's a hentai.
So it's, I would say it's probably, unless you really, really do not want to see that kind of show, it's probably worth seeing just the first episode.
Now I have to watch
to see how awful it could truly get, and then
I adore
the
those type of shows. They're just stupid, just stupid. It's over sexualized nonsense like Triage X. I adore that crap. So, like, yeah, that's right up my alley. If it's really that awful,
it is that awful, and you're gonna get into it like 15 seconds into the show, guaranteed.
See, I'm one of those people who thinks if Michael Bay didn't try to take his movie seriously, he'd be a great director. Because it just end up high-budget trogda. And that's what I see out of shows like that, or Triage X, or Valkyrie Drive. Because eventually, when you just stop giving a fuck, you go, hey, this action's actually really good. It's just like,
yeah, I'm not
you just kinda kind turn of your brain off and, you know, learn to love it.
I'm just not quite sure you're going to really get there. I much prefer shows like Shimoneta where you have that, but then there is a level where...
Shimoneta is very different. Shimoneta, there's actually a serious theme and a reason for it to
Right, exist. And I wish it had gotten into that area a little bit more.
The best example, High School of the Dead. It's zombies and tits. And if you want it, the show's great. If you don't like that, you're not going to like it. That's just what it is at its most base form.
What I liked about that show is if you take the second part out of the zombies plus tits out, it was a really good zombie show.
Yeah, it was a fantastic action show. But, you know, like, Triage X is the same way. If you ignore it,
Heart is not going to get you to that second level. It's
action, there's no action in it?
Oh, there's action in it, but it's...
Is it just bad? Because, like, I don't know, I doubt either you ever saw anything of Valkyrie Mermaid Overdrive, or whatever the fuck that show was, but there was some awesome action scenes in there, and it was animated really well. And sure, there was just tits everywhere, but, you know, at some level, if you just wanted action and tits, it filled that role very well.
I have to ask, did you ever watch Cross Ange?
No. No, I've heard
oh my
all...
God, you have to. Given what you've just said, you have to go watch that show.
I always heard Cross Ange was on the level of Queen's Blade, where it's like so terrible you can't even get past it for, you know, the purposes of it being just stupid hentai.
No, the reason why I really am super ambivalent about it, it was hyper-violent, hyper-sexual in some parts, but there was an underlying theme that if they had explored it fully, it could have been a terrific show.
Okay, well maybe I'll go back and give it a try.
And it throws in probably enough... otherworldly action stuff in there that it might keep you hooked on.
Usually these aren't shows I go back and watch. These are things like when I need just a break during the week, I turn it on when I want to just turn my brain off.
It's a good trash watch.
Yep.
I think we should probably move on from my report.
No, because I'm going to watch the first episode, and next time I'm on one of your podcasts, just review it in its totalitary. Just every gruesome detail.
Well, feel free to hit me up on Twitter and tell me how much I've added to your life by doing that.
Let's move on to some or actually, is there any other shows in the just main shows, not TV shorts?
Rewrite.
Oh, yeah.
Our friends go on about it all the time, so I guess
most of our friends are filthy key fans, so.
Yeah, well, I'm giving it a try. They say it's really good, so why not?
And I'm sure none of them are watching this, so screw you all. Please leave a comment if you are watching this so you can just flip us the bird. Yeah, Rewrite. That's the show.
It exists.
It exists.
I'll watch it.
It'll make all the key fans happy. Now let's go on to the TV shorts, which we can go by pretty fast. Bananyan. It's a show about a cat who is also a banana.
Yep. What more could he ask out of life?
I just hate that the title gives the whole premise away.
Yeah, it's...
I mean, it's such a deep show after all. I mean, after one episode, I'm hooked. I need to learn what's happening with the banana cat.
I want to see a lot of people eating bananas in that show. No, the horror!
Oh, God.
So, I tell you what short I'm super looking forward to. I can't pronounce the name, but it's about a guy who farts, apparently.
I watched the first episode on that. It is exactly what it looks like in it.
And that's exactly what I want out of it.
And the only other short I'm watching is the show by Rock Shorts, which, it'll get me until season 2, I suppose. And any other shows or shorts we want to talk about?
Not off the top of my head.
Alright, well, I think that is all we have for this special episode of Blatant Filler. So thank you for listening to this episode. If you would like to contact with any of us, our Twitter handles are in the description below. My name's JJ, but I go by the Journeyman66 pretty much everywhere.
I'm Mark. You can find me on Twitter at AnimeSpamBot. I'm a recovering former podcaster, so no other way of having me discuss anime besides Twitter. And here, thank you.
And you can find me on Twitter at Sakarion.
Yeah, and if you're watching this one on YouTube, be sure to subscribe to our channel and give us a like if you enjoyed this video. If you're listening to us via iTunes, then be sure to give us a review, whether it's good or bad. It helps us out. And be sure to leave any comments anywhere if you either disagree or agree with anything we said, want to provide anything regarding the show itself, or anything we forgot to bring up about the shows we talked about today. Or if you just want to leave a smiley face, that's appreciated as well. So until next time, later.
Bye.
See ya.
Make sure
probably,
your pants are
because
off.
It couldn't be any different from Flying Witch.
My pants are never on, JJ.
Then make sure
you've known me long enough to know this.
Then make sure you at least have some loop beside your chair.
JJ, you've known no. I keep a thick coat on at all times in case of emergencies. Watching the goat?
You're watching the goat? With your pants off?
I could
and
be.
Some loop? Are your turtles barking yet?
Yes. It's the ritual, actually. The ritual of the barking turtles. It's used to summon the Charizard on Pokemon Go. Who they told me online.
Well, how do you summon the Blastoise?
Oh, you don't want to know. There's a lot more turtles involved.
What do you do to the turtles?
It's not what you do to the turtles, it's what the turtles do to you.
Oh, jeez.
My coworker said the sentence, "That good Kush Mulan." And I was just like, that's a fucking podcast title right there.
No, mate, not the belt, not the ice, no.